Welcome to module 19 of point set topology part 1. Last time we had announced that we will do three important theorems in metric space theory. So two of them we have already done last time. The third one is Baer's category theorem. Before we even state this theorem, it is convenient to make a few definitions. Of course, one can make the statement without these definitions and so on. That is not a logical necessity. The definitions only make help in reducing the number of words we use ultimately. So let X be a topological space and A be a subset. So these notions I am introducing inside any topological space, not necessarily metric space. Remember that. A is called an F sigma set in X if it is the union of countably many closed subsets of X. This definition is cooked up just to take care of this kind of sets because they are not closed. You know, generally, an infinite union of closed sets is not closed. But however, in this theory, what happens is countable union of closed sets becomes very important. But you can't call them closed sets, so we have put a name for it. Usually F is used for closed sets, at least in German topology in those days. F was used for closed set. So the sigma is for like countability, you know, like summation, countable. So F sigma stands for countable union of closed subsets. Any set which can be written as countable union of closed subsets will be called F sigma. Similar to this one and dual to that is A is called a G delta set if it is the intersection of countably many open sets. So that's like De Morgan law, okay? So the explanation for G delta is same thing. G was used for open subsets and delta for intersections. So G delta is for countably many open subsets and then take the intersection. Let us continue with these definitions. If A is a countable union of nowhere dense subsets. Now there is a stronger word here, not just closed subsets, nowhere dense subsets. Then A is called a first category set or belonging to first category or just say first category. A set is set to first category if it is a countable union of nowhere dense subsets of X. So everything is happening in the ambient space X. Okay. If change X, the nature may change. Such a set is also called a meager set. If A is not of first category, then it is called second category. Just to make distinction between these two things, that's all, okay. Such a set is also called non-meager because it is not meager, that's all. Now there is one more terminology here. People are using this one. If a topological space itself is a second category, you call it a bare space. Okay, after the mathematician Baer. Okay, now let us state Baer's category theorem, which becomes very simple because of this terminology. Every complete metric space is of second category. What is the meaning of this? It is not first category. What is the meaning of that? It is not the union of, countable union of, nowhere dense subsets of X. The only condition is that X is a complete matrix space now. Okay. So statement becomes very easy. That is the whole idea. Now I have put this as BCT, Baer's category theorem 1, because there are several versions of this one. Okay. So I have picked up one of them, very simplest in terms of these definitions. So this is every complete metric space is second category. Before going into the proof, let us examine a couple of examples. Of course, every open set is G delta. There are many G delta sets which are not open. In some sense, they are the next best things to open sets. See, in topology, we always keep studying open sets, right? But in a metric space, G delta sets also become important. Okay. In a metric space, especially, every singleton set is a G delta set. Or you can write it as intersection of balls of radius 1 by n with center x as n rings over all positive integers. Right? In particular, every singleton set in Rn is also a G delta. That's precisely what we have done. In every metric space, it is true. All right. So similarly, every closed interval is also a G delta set, because you can write it as, say, A to B is a closed interval. You can take A minus 1 by n and B plus 1 by n and then take the intersection. Okay. So many interesting results on continuous real world functions follow from this observation. Namely, let X be any topological space and F from X to R be a continuous function. Then for every R in R, the set of all points X belonging to X such that Fx is equal to R. This is a G delta set. Why? Because singleton R is a G delta set. You can take the inverse image of all those countably many open sets, right? They will be open. When you take the intersection, it will be intersection singleton R. Do you understand what is going on here? Since singleton R can be written as intersection B 1 by N, right, R. You take the inverse image of that. They are, say, G Ns here. Intersection of that will be precisely R. So take any continuous function into R. Okay. So G delta, inverse image of open set is open. Inverse image of G delta is G delta. That is what I am trying to say here, more generally. All right. So there are some other more interesting examples. Any countable set in a metric space is F sigma by, you know, taking a duality. Because each singleton is a closed set, it's a countable union. Each interval in R is both F sigma as well as G delta. So we saw G delta. Similarly, we can take F sigma also. But now comes the set of irrational numbers is not F sigma. Okay. So I have given you examples, but there are not everything is F sigma or G delta. The set of irrational numbers is not F sigma inside R. For suppose it is like this, namely R minus Q is irrational numbers. Suppose you write it as countable union of closed sets. Okay. So that is the meaning of this is F sigma, right? Then being subsets of irrational numbers, we know that each Fn will be nowhere dense. Okay. As observed in example 1.89, let me just show you this example, which we have done, fourth one here. F is a closed subset of R, and is contained in either Q or R minus Q, then it is no ordered set. Right? We have seen this one. For F, it's a closed subset, so F bar is F. Interior of this one is same thing as interior of F bar, but that simply because F contains no intervals. Any subset of irrationals contains no intervals. So this is what we had seen earlier. So I'm just recalling it. It's important example here. Okay. So if you write it as union of Fn's, first of all, each Fn is closed, is an assumption, then each Fn becomes nowhere dense. But then you can put more, you know, another set of countable sets, namely all singletons. Okay, singletons are anyway nowhere dense, right? They also don't contain any intervals. But now R is inside Q, so this is a countable union. The whole thing is a countable union of closed sets and nowhere dense sets. So that shows that this R is written as union of nowhere dense sets. It means R is first category in our definition, right? But R is a complete metric space. So Baer's theorem just said you that every complete metric space is second category. So I have given you an application, you know, very simple minded application of Baer's theorem to show that you can, irrational numbers cannot be written as a countable union of closed sets. Of course, the rational numbers you can write. There is no contradiction, there is no harm. Okay, I will give you one more example. These are the easy things which are consequences of Baer's theorem. But that is not the end of Baer's theorem, we will see. So let us take another example here. Take a polynomial in n variables. Of course, if you take zero polynomial, it is not interesting. So non-constant polynomial, let us take. Okay. Look at all the zeros of that. That P is the zero set of P. All x1, x2, xn. When you evaluate P on that, P of x is zero. That is a closed set because P is continuous. All right. We claim that ZP contains no non-empty open set. It is nowhere dense. Okay. So this is elementary calculus. As soon as there is an open set of Rn or Cn, doesn't matter, contained inside a set, you can study the polynomial on that open set. Okay. Which is identically zero by definition, we have is contained in ZP, but a zero function on an open set has all its partial derivatives zero. If you compute partial derivatives cleverly, you can compute all the coefficients of this polynomial, not only in one variable, in any variable, any number of variables. You have to do all the partial derivatives, various partial derivatives. That means what? All the coefficients are zero. That means P itself is a zero polynomial, but we started with a non-constant polynomial. Okay, so the zero set of any polynomial is nowhere dense. What is the consequence? The entire Rn or Cn cannot be the union of countably many zero sets of polynomials. Okay, so that is the consequence by Baer's theorem. The zero set of any non-zero polynomial is nowhere dense. It follows that An, K could be R or C, doesn't matter. It has a union of countable many zero sets of non-zero polynomials. Okay, cannot be written. So let us prove this theorem now. We shall actually prove stronger version of the theorem. The stronger version I have put it at BCT 0 because it sits over all of them. Okay. Take a metric space which is complete. Take a sequence of, you know, countable family of nowhere dense subsets. The complement is also tense. That is the statement. X minus union of ans is dense in X. In particular, it is non-empty. An empty set cannot be dense because closure of an empty set is empty. Okay. That it is non-empty, same thing as BCT1 that we have seen. Because if it were empty, then X would have been union of ans. That would mean that X is first category, right? But the statement is X is second category. So BCT0 implies BCT1 very easily. So we are going to prove the stronger statement. All right. Once again, we have done the groundwork already. So this is in 1.107, it says, let us take a look at this one. Okay. Has it come there? Yeah. XT is a metric space. A subset A of X is nowhere dense if and only if each non-empty open set in X contains the closure of an open disk disjoint from A. So there is really some BRX0. Closure of that intersection with A will be empty. Okay. And this will be contained inside any given non-empty open set. So this theorem I am going to use again and again. Okay. So I have to go back now. Yeah. I had a statement here, but I wanted to show that we have actually done, you might have forgotten it. If A is a nowhere dense subset of X, then every open set in X contains the closure of an open ball disjoint from A. So this is the statement I'm going to use again and again. Okay. So this is precisely the kind of thing that we are going to be. This is dot, 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 dot is the nowhere dense set. This single line, thin line indicates an open set. Inside that, I can find a ball of some positive radius such that the closure is disjoint from all these points, dot, dot, dots. Okay, a nowhere dense set compared with an open set. Let B1 be any open ball of positive radius. You start with, instead of any open set, if I prove this one for B1, which is an open ball, then it will be proved for every open set. I will produce something inside B1. So starting with an open set, I can start with B1 instead, right? That's why let B1 be an open ball of radius. We need to show that B1 is not contained in the union of ans. That's enough. Okay. If B1 is an open ball, not contained in the union of an, that's all I want to show. By, first of all, B1 contains an open ball C1 such that the closure of C1 intersection A1 is empty because A1 is nowhere dense. So this is the first time I am applying this theorem. Okay, 107. Now I have got C1. Let B2 be an open ball inside C1 of radius R by 2. Okay, I am making sure that the radius are going down, down, down to 0 by putting R by 2 here. Okay. B2 is contained inside some C1. Okay, C1 is a ball, but I want a ball of radius smaller than this R, not just smaller, R by 2, R by 3, whatever, something like that. Okay. It contains, again, now I apply the theorem, contains an open ball C2 such that C2 bar intersection A2 is empty. Now you know the game. inductively, suppose you have chosen Cn of radius less than r by n, such that Cn is contained Cn minus 1 and Cn bar intersection n is empty. Once you have that, inside this Cn, you will get another one and so on. So you keep continuing this. Now we apply Cantor's intersection theorem to what? To these Cn's. C equal to intersection of Cn bars. So these are all closed subsets. Their diameters are what? Twice this one, say Rn, R by n, right? So twice that is diameter. As n tends to infinity, to go to zero. So this intersection is actually a single point. It's non-empty. All that I read is non-empty. Okay. Since I want to apply Cantor's theorem, I have put R bar by 2, R by 2, R by n, so on, R by n here. So this will go to zero. Therefore, C is intersection of this one is singleton, but I want only non-empty. But they are all contained in B1. Okay. So this point is inside B1. But what is this point? This point, C intersection AN is empty. Okay. Why? Why? Cn, it's containing Cn bar. And Cn bar intersection An is empty. So C intersection An is empty for all n. Right? So it is in none of the An's. This point, which is a single point actually, is not belonging to any of the An's. So I have formed a point which is not in An, which means B1 is not contained inside An. See, if you want to prove that something is dense, what you have to do? Take any open set, it should intersect the set. Intersecting the set means what? This set is what? X minus union of n's. That means it should not be contained inside the union of n. It's a complement, right? That's what I have proved. Take any open set. Okay. It is not contained inside union means what? Any open set is contains this one. It is not contained union means what? The complement intersects B1. Therefore, the complement is dense. Okay, be sure that we have proved this. Non-empty is not what we have proved. We have proved that X minus AN, union of AN, is actually dense. So that is the proof of this. Okay. So let me make a few remarks here. This theorem is very useful in function theory when one has to prove the existence of various types of functions. This theorem, something is non-empty. It's the way it is used. Okay. If you write a complete matrix space, you cook up a complete matrix space, then you cook up a sequence of closed subsets which are nowhere dense, they will not cover, means there is something left out. So that is the existence theorem. So that is the way it is used in many existence theorems. Okay, indeed, proofs of several fundamental results in functional analysis use this theorem. I will quote some of them, which are very, very fundamental, namely closed graph theorem, open mapping theorem, and boundedness principle, and so on and so forth. So all these things come in elementary functional analysis itself. The first course in functional analysis is all these theorems. Okay, they are all using Baer's category theorem to prove. All right. So I make thing I have already done. So I'll repeat this one. The above theorem has a negative tone. That means second category itself definition is it is not first category. The first category is what it cannot be. So there are too many negations there. But it can be put in slightly a positive tone as follows. So I have given you those two. And then often it is how this positive it is used. That versions are used here. So let us have those versions. Later on in part 2, we shall prove a version of this Baer's category theorem for locally compact Hausdorff spaces, which have nothing to do with metrizability. There is no matrix. Okay, so here are versions here. Let X be a complete matrix space. That is standard assumption. There is no other. The BC2 says that suppose X is union of ANs, written as a countable union ANs, then the closure of ANs, at least one of ANs, has non-empty interior. See, the hypothesis on ANs is deleted. This is just countable union. But when you conclude, I am taking closures, right? Instead of taking closed subsets and no ordinary subsets, one of them has non-empty interior means what? One of them is AN bar. Okay, non-empty interior means what? AN is no ordinance. Okay, so it is just the other way around here. So here there is no negation here. If you write like this, one of them is non-empty interior, it's a positive term. Another one is intersection of a countable family of open dense sets is non-empty. So this is the way it will be used. So there is one element they want. So that is the existence theorem. The proof of that, one implies two implies three and they are equivalent. Okay. This is very easy for you to prove. But zero is a stronger statement which will imply all of them. Okay. So here is exercise, namely write down versions of BC2 zero also similar to BC2 2 and BC3. Okay. Take a complete matrix space. Does BCT1 imply that union of countably many nowhere dense subsets of X is nowhere dense? Pay attention to the statement there. It does not say this. Union of countably many nowhere dense sets does not fill up the whole space. This is the weaker version. Complement is actually dense, is the stronger version. But nowhere to set that the union itself is nowhere dense. Okay. So you have to see whether this is true. Okay. It is not stated, doesn't mean that it is not implied. So I am asking whether it is whether this is implied in the from the statement. Think about them. So that is the exercise. You have to think about them, that's all. So let us stop here. Thank you.